Welcome back students to the video lecture series. I am Adil Mansoori from Civil Engineering Department of LJ Institute of Engineering and Technology. So my dear students, in the previous video we discussed about certain chemical properties. For example, we talked about total dissolved solids, then pH, alkalinity, acidity and hardness. So today we are starting with a new topic, that is the chlorides, right? That is a new chemical property, chlorides. So presence of chlorides is due to intrusion of seawater, brine, industrial waste and domestic waste into water supply system. So as we all know that the water supply system usually runs underground, right? Whatever the water is supplied to your houses is usually supplied in pipelines which are placed under the ground, right? So if there is any intrusion of seawater or brine or industrial waste or even domestic waste, then there may be chances that water will get contaminated of chlorides. Present in the form of calcium chloride, sodium chloride and magnesium chloride. Okay, so these are the three forms of chlorides which are present in the water. Talking about the environmental significance, chlorides in excess of 250 milligrams per liter produce salty taste in drinking water, okay, and hence it cannot be accepted, right? Then the presence of high quantity of chloride in a river or stream waters may indicate pollution of water due to sewage and industrial waste. Clear? Then fluorides. So water sources contain natural fluorides. They are mainly associated with some sedimentary and igneous rocks. It is toxic to humans and other animals in large quantities, while small concentration can be beneficial. For example, fluorides in water less than 1 milligram per liter can cause dental cavities in children, while more than 1.5 milligram per liter can cause discoloration or mottling of teeth, right? So next is metals. All metals are soluble in water up to certain extent, okay? They are not completely soluble, but they are soluble up to certain extent. And metals in natural water includes dissolution from natural deposits, discharge of domestic, industrial or agricultural wastewater. Talking about the environmental significance, toxic metals are harmful to humans and other organisms in small quantities, which are added to water by mining, industrial or agricultural activities. Okay. Then arsenic, barium, cadmium, chromium, lead and mercury are the toxic metals which might be present in water. Non-toxic metals commonly found in water include sodium, iron, manganese, aluminium, copper and zinc. Clear? So what is the environmental significance of metals? Excessive concentration of sodium cause a bitter taste in water and cause health hazard like cardiac problems or kidney problems. Iron and manganese impart color in very small quantities as well. Okay. Then let's talk about organic matter. So many organic matters are soluble in water. They come from natural sources, decay products of organic solids, or from human activities, wastewater from domestic, industrial or agricultural sources. So these are different sources from which the organic matters come from. Okay. So basically, looking at the types of organic matter, they are biodegradable and non-biodegradable. Okay, so biodegradable organic matters include starches, fats, proteins, alcohol, acids, aldehydes, and they are usually utilized by microorganisms for food. That is, microorganisms stay dependent on these biodegradable organic matters in order to survive themselves. Okay, then non-biodegradable, for example, tannic acid, cellulose, phenols, right? And they are resistant to biological degradation. That means they will not be degradable, they will not be eaten up by the microorganisms, right? So talking about the environmental significance, organic matter in water bodies utilize dissolved oxygen for degradation, right? Now we all know that oxygen is present in water, right? But if the oxygen is in dissolved form, then it is useful for microorganism as well as different aquatic animals, right? Because they consume that dissolved oxygen in order to synthesize food, right? So the amount of oxygen consumed during microbial utilization of organics is called biochemical oxygen demand. Okay, once again, the amount of oxygen which is consumed during microbial utilization of organic matter is called biochemical oxygen demand. Okay, so the amount of oxygen, right, which will be absorbed or which will be utilized by whom? Microorganisms. For what? For synthesis of food, right? So that is known as BOD or biochemical oxygen demand. Okay, so this process results in the reduction of dissolved oxygen because they are using the oxygen, hence there will be reduction in dissolved oxygen in water bodies, and hence it may affect the aquatic systems. Okay, so let us now talk about nitrogen and its compounds. So the presence of nitrogen in water indicates the presence of organic matter in water. Okay, there are different forms of nitrogen. Let's have a look at each of them. First one is called free ammonia. This indicates very first stage of decomposition of organic matter, right? It means that if in any water body free ammonia is present, right, then it is just starting decomposition of organic matter, right? And it will indicate that the water body is recently polluted. Okay, then nitrites, it indicates presence of partly decomposed organic matter. Okay, then nitrates, which indicates presence of fully decomposed organic matter. And last is known as albuminoid nitrogen, which indicates the quantity of nitrogen present in water before the decomposition of organic matter is started. Okay, so the presence of nitrogen is the function of organic matter. Okay, that is decomposition of organic matter. Clear? Okay, so talking about free ammonia, the presence of free ammonia in water indicates that the decomposition of organic matter has started recently. Okay, then the presence of free ammonia in potable water should not be exceeding 0.15 milligram per liter, and it can be easily measured by boiling the water and measuring the liberated ammonia gas by distillation process. Okay, so this was about the free ammonia. Let's talk about nitrites. So the presence of nitrites in water indicates that the organic matter present in water is not fully oxidized. Okay, for determining the presence of nitrites, the color is obtained by adding sulfonic acid and naphthamine. Okay, and the permissible amount of nitrates present in potable water should be nil, right? That is zero. Okay, then let's talk about nitrates. So the nitrates, the presence of nitrates indicates that organic matter present is in water is fully oxidized and water is no longer harmful. And the presence of too much of nitrates in water may adversely affect the health of infants, causing a disease called methemoglobinemia, okay, which is also known as blue baby disease. Okay, then for testing presence of nitrates, the color is obtained if phenol disulfonic acid and potassium hydroxide are added. Okay, and the colors so obtained are compared with standard colors to ascertain the parts per million contents. Okay, and the nitrate concentration in domestic water supply is generally limited to 45 milligram per liter. Okay, so this was about nitrates, and the last one is the albuminoid nitrogen, that is also known as organic nitrogen. So the presence of albuminoid nitrogen in water indicates the quantity of nitrogen present in water before decomposition of organic matter has started, right? So the quantity of albuminoid nitrogen should not exceed 0.3 ppm, and it can be easily measured by adding strong alkaline solution of potassium permanganate to already boiled water sample and by again boiling the same and measuring the ammonia gas liberated. Okay, so the sum total of ammonia nitrogen and organic nitrogen is known as Jeldahl nitrogen. So let us move ahead. So next topic is dissolved gases, right? So the various gases which may dissolve in water due to its contact with the atmosphere or the ground surface may be nitrogen, methane, hydrogen sulfide, carbon dioxide and oxygen. Okay, and the content of these dissolved gases in water may be worked out so as to get the idea of the extent of contamination of water and the treatment required for purifying the water. Okay, so as we all know that water gets in contact with two things. First thing is the atmosphere and the second thing is the ground surface, right? And different gases such as nitrogen, methane, hydrogen sulfide, carbon dioxide and oxygen gets mixed with it and dissolved in it, right? So we need to identify how much is the extent of dissolved gases, right? Because dissolved gases, when present in water, they are not permissible, right? So we first need to find out how much is the extent of contamination of water and how much treatment is needed or which treatments are needed in order to purify the water before supply. Okay, so let's talk about dissolved oxygen. So surface water gets oxygen dissolved either from atmosphere or due to activities of algae, okay, and other tiny plants live in water. So its content in surface water is dependent upon the amount and character of the unstable organic matter present in water, as microorganisms require dissolved oxygen for aerobic decomposition of the biological degradable matter, right, or biodegradable organic matter. Clear? The amount of oxygen that water can hold depends upon temperature. Okay, and it can hold smaller oxygen at higher temperature. That is, for example, at 20 degrees centigrade, dissolved oxygen content is about 9.2 milligram per liter, right? While at 30 degree, it is just 7.6 milligram per liter. Okay. Again, adequate dissolved oxygen is necessary in water to support the life of fish and other aquatic organisms. Fishes may start dying if dissolved oxygen in water is less than 4 milligram per liter. Okay. Now, the presence of oxygen in water in dissolved form is necessary to keep it fresh and sparkling. But more quantity of oxygen may cause corrosion to the pipe material. okay, because we already know that for any kind of corrosion, the main governing factor is the presence of oxygen, right? So if the more quantity of oxygen is present in the water, then it will cause the corrosion into the pipe material, okay? So if the oxygen present in water is found to be less than its saturation level, it indicates presence of organic matter and consequently making the water suspicious, okay? Now, the simple test which can be performed to determine the oxygen deficiency in water is to mix the water sample with 10% acid solution of potassium permanganate and to expose the mixture for 4 hours at 27 degree centigrade. The quantity of oxygen absorbed can then be calculated by titration, and this amount for potable water should not exceed 5 to 10 ppm. Okay, so let's talk about dissolved carbon dioxide. Okay, so carbon dioxide gets dissolved in water from the atmosphere from decomposing organic matter at the earth's surface or from underground sources, right? Higher carbon dioxide content makes water acidic, increasing corrosivity of water, and it is also responsible for testing water. Now, if water comes across calcium and magnesium salts, the carbon dioxide acts on them and converts them into bicarbonates and causes hardness in water. The presence of carbon dioxide in water indicates biological activities and increases the solubility of many minerals. Okay, then the presence of carbon dioxide can be easily determined by mixing the lime solution in water. If it gives milky white color, the carbon dioxide is present in water. The amount of carbon dioxide in water can be reduced either by aeration process or by addition of alkali. Its quantity in water can be found out by titration with alkali of pH 8 to 8.5. using phenolphthalein as indicator. Okay, students, so that's all for today's video. We will discuss some more topics in the next video.